Overwatch is a game that focuses on teamwork. As a team, you need to work together to wrestle control of a portion of the map from the enemy team by directing aggression and protecting teammates in the tank role, hitting weak points in the enemy's defenses in the damage role, and improving your team's performance by healing your team as well as increasing their damage, speed, and in general keeping them alive when they're in danger with the support role. Now, I'm not the best player of the game. I certainly don't put in the hours upon hours a professional streamer would constantly playing the game. Therefore, take what I say with a grain of salt. That being said, I do enjoy the game and find it to be pretty engaging, challenging, and fun. I'm Alain Galvan, and this is GameArch, a show where I discuss interesting games, looking at them from a gameplay perspective, as well as an architectural engineering perspective. So let's review how Overwatch renders a single frame. Note, this is not an official analysis of the Overwatch renderer. We won't be discussing everything that their renderer does, just key aspects of it and referencing techniques where appropriate. Overwatch begins a frame by generating orthographic depth projections for each of their shadow casting lights, rendered at 2048 by 2048 in medium settings. In this scene, there is one directional light and one omnidirectional light, rendered as a cube map that is 512 by 512 per face. Following the depth prepass, there is a pass where shadows are resolved in a super texture with different noise samples that are composited together later during lighting. Overwatch has a standard prepass with view space normals, albedo, metalness, roughness, emissive, and view space depth, encoded for use in later passes. The distances in view space depth imply that they use centimeter units. These and subsequent passes are rendered with 33% more pixels on the y-axis for fast anti-aliasing. Ambient occlusion is rendered first with view space AO, then composited with baked ambient occlusion. The reflection pass begins with a prepass that is used to determine target surfaces used for reflections, which is then composited with the metalness and roughness of that surface to determine the final mask in green. Then there is a raycast from those appropriately reflective surfaces, a horizontal blur to help with azimuth reflection scaling, something physically based reflection approximations have trouble doing, a grow pass, then a MIP level pass for metalness and roughness pre-integration. The diffuse lighting pass renders lighting for each individual light object visible in the scene. This scene had more than 20. If the pre-pass wasn't already indicative of the presence of a PBR renderer, this pass confirms it. Here we're rendering our specular lighting by taking advantage of our pre-pass and image-based lighting from the skybox. The bloom pass here is pretty standard across the gaming industry. The same scaling, blurring, compositing effect that can be found everywhere from Unreal to Unity to everything in between. In the mask pass, Overwatch renders out allies, then enemies. First they render the mask, then grow the mask, then apply a Sobel operator to the mask to get the final outline. Prior to the UI pass, there's a pre-pass that renders out aspects of the UI that are encoded as scalable vector art to a render target. It also renders these at different blur levels for shadows or bloom effects. Finally, the UI pass, where all the UIs are drawn, completing the frame. All in all, it's clear that the rendering engineers, technical artists, and individual artists over at Blizzard are very attentive to their rendering budget. So while not extremely flashy, this design is clearly meant to run absolutely anywhere and everywhere at a smooth 60 frames a second, and it shows. If this was insightful, or if you have any suggestions for a game to analyze, let me know in the comments below, and I'll see you next time.